Suppose you have a bag with five counters in it, three red ones and two blue ones. You're going to draw out two counters in a row without replacement. That means you're going to pull out one counter and then pull out a second one without putting the original one back in first. Let's draw a tree diagram to model this experiment. The first counter could be one of three red ones or one of two blue ones. Now work across the page from left to right for the second counter. If the first counter is red, then there are only two red counters left for the second draw. And if the first counter is blue, then there are three red counters left, but only one blue counter left for the second draw. And that's all well and good. But what if I asked you to extend the experiment to drawing out three counters in a row without replacement? Suddenly the tree becomes a bit large and unwieldy, doesn't it? You could draw it, but there are so many options to try to fit in, and they're all so similar, it would be very easy to get confused trying to read anything off the diagram. So what we do instead is draw a simplified tree diagram. It works like this. The first counter could be red or blue. The chance of getting a red one is 3 out of 5, and the chance of getting a blue one is the other 2 out of 5. Now the second counter. If the first one was red, then the second one could still be red or blue. But since we're not replacing the first counter, the chance of getting a second red one is now 2 out of 4. There are only 4 counters left in the bag, and 2 of them are red. The other 2 are blue, so there's the chance of getting a blue counter on the second draw, if the first one was red. Okay, so what about if the first counter was blue? Then the second could be red or blue, and there are 3 red counters left out of 4, but only 1 blue left out of 4. Now the third draw. If the first 2 counters were both red, then there are 3 counters left in the bag, 1 red one and 2 blue ones. If the first was red and the second blue, or the first blue and the second red, then in both of these cases there are 3 counters left, 2 red ones and 1 blue one. Now think carefully about the final case. If both of the first 2 counters are blue, then there are only 3 red counters remaining. You are now certain to get a red counter on the next draw. It's important here to note that with a simplified tree diagram like this, you can't simply count the outcomes on the right-hand side of the tree. Although there are 7 possible outcomes here, they are not all equally likely. To calculate the theoretical probability of any individual outcome, you have to multiply the probabilities of each partial event that got you to that outcome. Remember to work across the tree from left to right. You multiply the probabilities that you wrote on the tree for each branch from the start on the left along the path to the outcome you're interested in. Let me show you another example. Suppose I roll 3 dice in a game where the only thing that matters is whether or not I roll a 6. What's the probability of getting at least 2 sixes, exactly 1 six, or no sixes? In this case, the only thing I care about after each roll is whether I roll a 6. So the first die could come up as a 6 or as something else. And there's a 1 in 6 chance of getting a 6 and 5 in 6 chance of not getting a 6. Then the second die with the same chance for each outcome and the third. Now let's consider the probabilities. There are 4 ways to get through this tree to get at least 2 sixes. But the chance is not 4 out of 8. Remember, to calculate the probability of each of these outcomes, I have to multiply the probabilities of each branch along the way from left to right. So the first way, 3 sixes, is 1/6 times 1/6 times 1/6, which is 1 in 216. The second, 2 sixes followed by something else, is 1/6 times 1/6 times 5/6, or 5 in 216. The third way, a 6, not a 6, then a 6, is the same probability. And the fourth way, with the not a 6 roll first, is also 5 in 216. So the theoretical probability of getting any one of these four mutually exclusive options is simply the addition of these fractions, which comes to 16 out of 216, which simplifies to 2 in 27, or about 7.4%. There are three ways of getting exactly 1/6, and they each have the same likelihood, 25 out of 216. So the theoretical probability of rolling exactly 1/6 is 3 times this fraction, 75 out of 216, or 25 out of 72, about 34.7%. And there's only one way in this tree to get no sixes, but it's a fairly common outcome because there's actually many different rolls hiding along this one path. It's 5 times 5 times 5, or 125 out of 216. That's around 57.9%. Now imagine how hard it would be to work these out by drawing a complete tree diagram with all 216 outcomes at the right-hand side.